So I'll talk about a complete artificial photosynthesis. And the thing that really fascinated me about photosynthesis, and I hope it would fascinate you if you really think about it, photosynthesis takes air, and it takes sunlight, which is hard to get your hands around, and water, and it builds all of this around us, which is a truly amazing accomplishment, to take air, sunlight, and water, and then make this. And so we were interested in that process, and could we duplicate it? Now, one thing I would like to do is tell you the motivation for our work, to put it into context. And what we think about in terms of a sustainable world is usually this, a blue earth and green leaves. What we forget about, and my contention is, this can't exist if you don't take care of the poor of the world. And so unless you eliminate poverty, it's impossible to have a sustainable planet. And I'll show you why I say that in a minute. Before I do that, so the target was to take an artificial photosynthesis, but develop it for the poor of the world. And that was our motivation in undertaking all this work. Now, in discussing an energy system for the poor versus us in the developed world, I'm just showing this graph. And what I did is I took, this is kind of interesting, I took just the price of a good and I divided it by its weight. That's all I did. So how much does it cost to manufacture a Boeing 777? And then I divided it by its weight. And then I said, how many did you make in a year? And in 2010, there were 74 Boeing 77s made. Then I did it for etching tools, machine tools, and automobiles, and you get this curve. That's a manufacturing curve. That doesn't work for pharma pills, because we don't manufacture pharma this way. It doesn't work for commodity chemicals, and it doesn't work for Intel chips. But for manufactured goods, this is how the world works. And so weight costs money. Now, the reason I'm showing this is it works for lots of things you manufacture. So I didn't know this, but McDonald's has a chief technology officer, and I called the chief technology officer, and he told me if you take the weight, and I just wanted to know the weight of the bun and the lettuce and the tomato, and it comes out to $10 per pound. So what this curve says is you can never be cheaper than $10 per pound in anything you manufacture, including a hamburger. So this hamburger, I've related to an automobile. They're very different technologically, but it comes out in terms of a manufacturing curve to be the same. Now, the reason why this is interesting is the way we build energy systems in the developed world is we build one thing. It's very heavy, and when you multiply by $10 per pound, it costs a lot of money. And so to build a plant, it's around $1.5 billion. But then you also have to have an energy infrastructure, which you've already built, to accommodate this energy system. The problem is for the poor of the world, they don't have the money to build these large systems, and people won't invest in the poor parts of the world. And so they don't have the high CapEx ability to duplicate our energy system. And this is getting to the meat of why we were interested in the poor. Thank goodness, because if we have the poor building this energy system, we will have really big problems with sustainability. So a different way to say this, I'm going to now put this in terms of hamburger speak, if you allow me to do that. If McDonald's built, they had a business model the way we build energy systems. Did you ever think of what it would look like? It would be one big hamburger that we would all drive to, take a bite out of it, and then drive home. So that's how McDonald's would build an energy system in the developed world. But how do they do business. They have a distributed network. They build lots of little things that is accessible to everybody. So I wish I could be more complicated than this. We decided for the poor, since this wouldn't work, we wanted to try to build the McDonald's hamburger of energy. So you'll see if I did that or not by the time I'm done. Now, why am I so concerned about this energy system for the poor? And I published this a few years ago. We use 16 terawatt equivalents of energy. So the world's burning a 16 trillion watt light bulb. It's on all the time, and we give it mostly coal, oil, and gas. By 2050, you'll need 16 trillion watts more. And that is with the assumption that every bit of energy we use today will save in the future. And so with unprecedented conservation, the world still will need 16 trillion watt equivalents. And that's because there's 3 billion low energy users in the world, mostly in the continent of Africa, Indonesia, India, and rural China. And then the 3 billion people to come in the next 40 years are coming into those poor parts of the world. So in the next 40 years, our Earth will see basically 6 billion new energy users. And this now gets to the point I made that if we don't provide them the right flavor of energy and they duplicate what we're doing, which is fossil fuels, in my view, it will be impossible to have a sustainable planet. So that's why we targeted our research to go after this problem. And to do that, and what I mean by non-legacy is the poor haven't built a large energy infrastructure, so they haven't inherited an energy system. They don't have a legacy in energy. We thought that because of the graph I just showed you, it has to be low capex, and that means you need to invent and do research to allow simplicity. Once you get to high complexity, it involves lots of engineering, weight, and then cost. Distributed, just like the hamburger, highly manufacturable. And then this is was very important to us. If you're going to the poor, you want to make sure they have access to the same energy you do. And that naturally leads you to this, the leaf. Because the leaf is a highly distributed system. It's simple in terms of its manufacturing, not in its function. And it uses the energy source that's available to everybody, the sun. Now, in talking about photosynthesis, I want to break it down because there's a misconception with photosynthesis that you use sunlight to go the entire distance to make biomass or carbohydrate. But in an energy sense, that isn't necessarily true. What happens is the sunlight in the leaf is used simply to split water, like was mentioned in the introduction, to make oxygen and hydrogen. And then nature stores hydrogen in a solid form, NADPH. In the dark, it takes the hydrogen plus carbon dioxide to make biomass. So this reaction you can run in the dark. The sunlight is only needed to provide the high energy content fuel of hydrogen from the rearranged bonds of water to make O2 and hydrogen. And so this is an important concept in design because what it says is if you want to emulate photosynthesis, I relax myself of one big requirement. I don't need the sunlight to drive through this entire process. I need sunlight only to split water to make hydrogen. And then I have much more flexibility in taking the hydrogen plus carbon dioxide to biomass. And that was a critical insight for us when we started this project. The other way to say it is the sunlight is stored in the production of oxygen and hydrogen. So that's where you do energy storage. The biomass is actually a hydrogen storage mechanism. It's a convenient way to store the hydrogen that you've made from sunlight in a usable form. So we set out with this in mind that we could break this problem into two pieces. Now, digging a little deeper, I'm going to explain from more a systems engineering point of view, how photosynthesis works. And I'm leaving out all the beautiful complexity of this photosynthetic membrane. So the way the leaf works is the leaf couldn't get its hands around sunlight. So what it did is it immediately changes the sun into an electromotive force, charge. So sunlight hits the photosynthetic membrane and you make an electron and a hole and they go in opposite directions. So moving charge is current, and whether you realize it or not, leaves are buzzing with electricity, just no wires. It then stores the current in cofactors, the oxygen evolving complex and the iron reductase. So the positive charge is stored in the oxygen evolving complex. The negative charge is stored in the iron reductase. The leaf takes 4 units of charge, and when it has 4 positive charges and 4 negative charges, it raises the energy of the cofactor, and with those 4 units of charge, it then splits water to make oxygen and hydrogen. So our first task was, could we emulate this? And the way we're going to emulate it, and you were right, Bill, it's not a biomimicry, it's only functionally. Could we take a material where we separate charge a unit at a time, times 4, store that charge in cofactors, in our case it will be catalysts, and then have the energized catalyst act on water to make oxygen and hydrogen. And then later on, in the dark, could we then take hydrogen and CO2 and make biomass or fuels? So that was the conception of doing this. Now, in taking this problem on, I wish I could tell you I started working on this only 10 years ago. I started working on this when I was 24 years old. It's been an entire life journey. Because when I started this problem, the coupling of a proton to an electron was ill-defined. Thermodynamically, it was known from the 30s. That was by a scientist named Porbay. But kinetically, how electrons and protons talk to each other, that was unknown. And the reason this is important, especially for this reaction, you can see it's a 4-proton, 4-electron reaction, is if you don't couple the proton to the electron, I can calculate the energy of that. So in taking H plus to H2, that is a 0-volt reaction. The way chemists define this thermodynamics is they have the standard hydrogen electrode. So this is an energy thermoneutral reaction, but if I don't couple the proton to the electron, I then add 1 electron to a proton to make H dot. That's 2.3 volts uphill. Then when I add the next electron and proton, I get 2.3 volts back. And so to run a 0-volt or thermoneutral reaction, I had to waste 2.3 volts of energy if I don't couple the proton and the electron. On the oxygen, this is for hydrogen, on the oxygen side, the same story, but in this case, you pull 1 electron out of water and it's uncoupled from the proton, you make OH dot, that's 3.4 volts uphill. And this is the energy storage part. When you split water thermodynamically, you store 1.23 volts of energy. So if you're not good at coupling electrons and protons, what happens is you'll have a very inefficient energy system, and I'll be wasting most of my solar energy in thermal energy. So many, many years ago, we set out to define this problem. It's a tricky one, because electrons are quantum mechanical and they're wave-like. Protons are much less quantum mechanical. They're quantum mechanical, but on a smaller length scale. Because of the mass difference of an electron to a proton, the mass difference being around 2,000, electrons, this is the sort of the wave function schematically for an electron. An electron can move by the overlap of the wave function. Because they're wave-like, electrons can move over long distances. Protons, being much heavier, can only tunnel over short distances. So if I have an electron and proton, they get decoupled because the electron can basically take off, but the proton is stuck to move on a very small length scale. So we needed to understand this problem to design catalysts that could split water in an energy-efficient way. And the way we did it, I don't want to go into, this was years of work, but the idea we had is if the electron can move a long distance and the proton can only move a short distance, the way we could see how they talk to each other is we would start the electron way over here. Say this is the finish line in a molecule. We would build molecules. So we would build a molecule where the electron would start way over there. The proton would start right near the finish line. And then when we hit it with a fast laser, the electron and proton would arrive at the same point at the same time. And when they arrive there, we could start building a theory and understand how electrons talk to protons. And we did this with my colleague at the time. I began my career at Michigan State with Bob Couquier. And we designed the first theories to tell us how electrons spoke to protons by using these laser experiments, these kinetic laser experiments. With that knowledge, we were able to build this catalyst here. Matt Cannon did this. So after years of work, Matt was able to take all this knowledge of proton-coupled ET and build this cobalt catalyst, which forms in a beautiful way. You don't have to be a chemist that knows a lot of synthetic chemistry. You can just take cobalt and dissolve it in solution, cobalt 2+. And if you have an electrode and you just pull an electron out of cobalt, you make cobalt 3+. In the presence of phosphate, it self-assembles on the electrode. So you just pass current into a solution of cobalt 2+ and phosphate, and on the electrode surface, there's an electrode surface, we're passing positive current through this electrode surface, this catalyst forms. When you bring that catalyst to synchrotron radiation and then do a real-time structure as the catalyst is operating, you find out this isn't it's a heterogeneous material, but it's not an extended solid. It's actually a molecular compound. And it has cobalts stitched together with oxygens, terminated with phosphate around the edges. Now, that compound is extremely interesting for a number of reasons. One is it looks very much like the oxygen evolving complex of photosystem 2, which is the cofactor that splits water to oxygen. So I've just done the line drawing of the manganese oxygen evolving complex. It's a cube, and then on one corner is calcium, and then there's this dangling manganese. If I take that cube and replace it with cobalt, so I'm going to replace manganese with cobalt, and then I'll do a head-to-tail dimerization, rotate it by 45 degrees, I get that piece of the cluster, of this metallate cluster. So this compound that forms spontaneously is a bunch of fused cubanes that have the same basic structural element of the oxygen evolving complex. The oxygen evolving complex in nature assembles from solution. Manganese 2 gets oxidized to manganese 3 and it forms. This gets, like I said, oxidized from cobalt 2 to 3 and it forms. I'm not going to tell you about, after years of work, we figured out the mechanism of the proton-coupled electron transfer. The electron-proton inventory of the oxygen evolving complex is precisely the same as this compound when it splits water. The one property I want to mention about this catalyst, which took us a long time to finally describe properly, but this is what we wanted to do when we made this catalyst, is it's self-healing. Now, what I mean by this catalyst being self-healing, and this is a data slide that is around 5 years of work. Using electrochemistry, we could put together rate laws for how fast the catalyst splits water to make oxygen. And remember, this catalyst is only doing the oxygen piece now. We'll get to hydrogen in a minute. So this catalyst splits water to make O2. That's the rate law for it, and that is the data, there's the line that fits that equation. The important thing about this line is it has an inverse dependence on proton to a first power. This is the rate law for forming the catalyst. I told you it self-assembles. Those are the red dots, the data, and then there's the line of this equation. That has an inverse third order, so the slope is much steeper. So look at pH 7. So if we're going to operate out of a glass of water, we'll be at pH 7. When this catalyst has enough potential, it needs 1.2 volts at pH 7 to split water to oxygen. So when it has 1.2 volts to split water, it has overpotential. I only need 1 volt to drive that assembly reaction. So as long as this catalyst is working and doing its job in splitting water to oxygen, it can always drive the self-assembly, self-healing process and keep forming. So if the catalyst were to corrode and dissolve in solution, I have enough overpotential, potential to redrive the oxidation of cobalt 2 back to cobalt 3 and reform it. And that makes it a self-healing catalyst. There aren't self-healing catalysts. This is the first self-healing catalyst. So what chemists usually do is they don't do healing, they do repair. They'll run a catalyst, then the catalyst will begin corroding or die, and then it gets deactivated, then they chemically reactivate it to put it back in its cycle. And what I just explained, what we did is we put an equilibrium inside the catalytic cycle. And so it's always fixing itself as it's operating. The other way to say this is a metric catalysis people use in designing catalysts is turnover number. So it's how many times does my catalyst turn over before it dies? And so you have a finite turnover number. If you think about the self-healing process, because of that internal equilibrium, the turnover number for this catalyst is infinite. So those two fundamental discoveries, first, figuring out how protons talk to electrons, which then enabled us to make a self-healing catalyst, then gave us lots of leeway and flexibility in now trying to design an energy system that looks like a hamburger, that's going to split water to oxygen and hydrogen using sunlight, and then we'll have to figure out how to take the hydrogen and carbon dioxide and fix it to make carbohydrates and fuels. So by operating under benign conditions, we have a lot of flexibility in terms of integrating to materials because we're in a non-corrosive environment, water. And we can also interface to bioorganisms. So those two science discoveries sort of opened up lots of avenues for us. There's one other subtle thing here. We can operate out of any water source. So we've run it out of the Charles River, which runs in front of Harvard. We've run it out of the ocean, Boston Harbor. We can run it out of a puddle of water on the ground. And this is the only catalyst that works out of a puddle on the ground. Usually you need pure water called 18 mega ohm water, so high resistance water, no impurities. And the problem with high resistance water, which is where most catalysts need to operate, is if you have to then begin distributing pure water all over the world, if you want to go to the poor, you're going to be in big trouble. So this ability to be able to use any water source opens up, again, from an application point of view down the road, a lot of possibilities. So the self-healing was critical to us for these areas. So the first thing is, how do we integrate to materials? So the way that people had been integrating catalysts and light absorbers, because right now I only have a catalyst that splits water to oxygen. I don't have a hydrogen catalyst, and I don't have anything to manage sunlight yet. So the way that had been done is And this goes back to the famous discovery of Honda and Fukushima in 1967. They use titanium oxide. You shine light on it, and it splits water to oxygen and hydrogen. That's called, and from that discovery, the next 50 years of work focused on what are called liquid junction photoelectrochemical cells. And what a liquid junction is you design a semiconductor that absorbs the light, and it also does the catalysis. So titanium oxide would absorb light and then do the catalysis of water splitting to O2. The problem with that approach is a good semiconductor only wants to make one hole in one electron. As a matter of fact, if it tries to make more than one hole in one electron, that leads to what's called defect sites, where the semiconductor loses efficiency. I just showed you that a good water splitting catalyst has to do proton coupled electron transfer with four electrons and four protons, and we're breaking bonds. So the last thing you want to do with a semiconductor is have it do chemistry. And so the field for many years hadn't really advanced because too much was combined and demanded out of a single material. So what makes a good catalyst makes a bad semiconductor and vice versa. So what we decided to do is a different approach with this idea called a buried junction. And the way we did this, now I'm only operating on the oxygen side still, is we said, could we take silicon, and this is an NPP plus silicon junction. So silicon can put out, in this junction that we made, put out 0.6 volts. Remember, I need 1.2 volts to split water. So a single junction doesn't have enough voltage to split water. So we have to put metal contacts on there to get extra voltage into the silicon. We'll be splitting water with this catalyst using our PCET mechanism to make O2, but oxygen plus silicon combined to make SiO2 sand. So we had to put a thin conducting layer that protected the silicon, and we used fluorinated tin oxide. Now what you can do with this device is I could hook this up to wires, I won't use sunlight yet, and just run it as a regular electrode. And that's what we did. So here, what you see is I oxidize. This is the self-assembly where cobalt 2 gets to cobalt 3, and I self-assemble this catalyst. And then as I get to 1.2 volt, that big increase in current is making oxygen. So that's what this is right here. The difference in what makes this electrode special is it has a NP plus single junction silicon. So this is when the sun is off, but when I turn sunlight on, I told you I can generate an internal voltage of 0.57 volts theoretically. And you can see once I turn the sunlight on, I don't have to put as much external voltage into the system. As a matter of fact, it's almost perfect. We almost collect the entire voltage that the silicon's capable of 0.5 volts. So all of a sudden, I'm using the sunlight to help me drive water splitting at a lower voltage, a lower energy than I need with a regular electrode. Now that's a single junction. So the next question is, if it's a single junction, could I then put three of them together? If it's around 0.5 volts, 0.5 times 3 would be 1.5 volts. I would have enough voltage to split water. I'll put my oxygen catalyst on the positive side of the current that's generated when sunlight goes in. And then this was very quick for us to do. We made a nickel molybdenum zinc alloy, and that makes hydrogen. And what we did is a trick that chemical engineers use, which is called de-alloying. You can electrolyze out the zinc and make a sponge-like nickel molybdenum compound. Now, this is called a buried junction, and the beauty of that is now I can design this independently from my catalysis. So here I can make a very good one-electron, one-hole separator that absorbs sunlight, and then I can manage the very complicated proton-coupled electron transfer chemistry of water splitting. So by decoupling this, we were able to move very quickly. And what we did is we took amorphous silicon. Amorphous silicon is a strained lattice. The silicon bonds are strained. So that absorbs at 400 nanometers. And then we doped germanium in here. And this is not our invention. This is applied physics cookbook 101. Like if you're an applied physicist and you make a junction, we just read the cookbook. So as you dope more germanium in there, germanium is big, it relaxes the silicon lattice, and you can tune it to wherever you want in the absorption spectrum. So we tuned the middle layer there. You add more germanium and you tune to there. So now the absorption of the silicon is that plus that plus that, and it's this curve, and you can see that curve almost perfectly overlays the solar absorption spectrum, meaning we're going to collect all the sunlight. That 0.5 plus 0.5 plus 0.5 puts out around 1.5 volts, so we have plenty of voltage. And so now what happens is you can literally take this, which is just layers, drop it in a glass of water, hold it up to the window, and it magically starts making oxygen and hydrogen. And what happens is the sun comes in just functionally like a leaf. It will split one unit of charge, and second unit of charge, third and fourth. It pumps this up to the four holes it needs to run that proton-coupled electron transfer reaction of water splitting to O2. The electrons go to the other side where they combine with protons and make hydrogen. And we've now hit efficiencies of around 10.2% with a nickel catalyst, not cobalt. We hit 12.8. The field is now moved totally to buried junctions. They've given up on liquid junctions. And people all over the world now are hitting 12 to 13% with this approach of a buried junction. My guess is in the next few years, we're going to hit 15 to 16%. So what that means is sunlight in to hydrogen with an energy efficiency of 16%. Only 10 years ago, the Department of Energy in the United States had 6% as their target. So as a science, we are now gone way by the US Department of Energy target for water splitting to make oxygen and hydrogen. And I told you it looked like a hamburger. It does. Look, that is my hamburger, the silicon. I need a protective layer of cheese, the FTO, to make sure the oxygen doesn't get to it. My top bun is the cobalt catalyst, and my bottom bun is the nickel catalyst. What I like about this is there's no wiring, there's no extra weight. I don't need a chem engineer. You can actually make this by chemical vapor deposition, just from the gas phase. You can make all these materials. And it's just coatings. And that's one thing we do well as an engineering, chem engineering, material science society, is we know how to coat materials. We don't have to necessarily need membranes. You need to get the protons to the other side, but you can use bypasses, like holes in the silicon. Chem engineers, Rachel Sagelman at University of Santa Barbara has shown you can get the protons over to the other side quickly with bypasses. It's simple engineering. So again, the whole idea is to reduce complexity, reduce weight, reduce cost. And so that's what we call frugal innovation. So there's a lot of science discovery that had to go into this. That's all I'm trying to say. Just these are hard things to do, but thank goodness because of our understanding of PCET and self-healing, we were able to do this. But, and that's where the field usually stops with artificial photosynthesis, water splitting, oxygen and hydrogen. But like I said, the beauty of photosynthesis is it builds this because it takes hydrogen and CO2 and it makes things, biomass, cellulose, lignin. So only 3 years ago, we got interested in how would we do this. And this is I'm going to come back to this critical point. This is where the sun stores energy. That negative number means I had to store 1.23 volts of energy. Once I have hydrogen, and I've kept hydrogen separated, so this is 3 moles of hydrogen, 4, 9, 12. Once I have hydrogen combining with CO2 to make fuels, it's a thermoneutral. It's a flat energy landscape. So I don't need the sun now. That's the beauty. What we decided to do is turn to biology. Why did we go to biology? Well, I just told you I started at 24 years old to split water, which is a 4-electron, 4-proton reaction. Look at some of these, 30 protons, 30 electrons. So that was intimidating. The other thing is, look at all these products you make in a very narrow energy window. So it's very difficult to be selective. And then another thing that's difficult is making carbon-carbon bonds. So stringing together lots of carbons is a difficult task. If you look at most CO2 reduction schemes in the literature right now, it's take CO2 to CO or CO2 to methanol, and all you're doing there is hydrogenating a C1. You're not making carbon-carbon bonds, because it's a difficult task to make those carbon-carbon bonds, manage all these protons and electrons, and do it selectively when you have so many products you could go to. So that said to us, we should turn to biology, because that's the beauty of biology. It knows how to handle these sorts of issues. And what we realize is the entire front end of photosynthesis, which is the photosynthetic membrane that I showed you, PS1, photosystem 1 and 2, we can now replace, because photosystem 1 and 2 is there only to split water to hydrogen and oxygen. But we can do that now using our artificial leaf or our catalyst for the artificial leaf. We can split water to hydrogen and oxygen. So I don't need this, but what I do need, and I can use the machinery of a bacterium, and the bacterium we used is Ralstonia eutropha. But the problem is how do I wire the solar hydrogen to the bacterium? And the way we did that is with hydrogenases. Hydrogenase is an enzyme that takes H2 to 2 protons and 2 electrons. So it just splits hydrogen into electrons and protons. On the back end of that, you can use what's called an NADPH reductase to get to NADPH. Once I'm there, I can go to ATP, and once I have ATP, I have cellular energy, and so I can drive this machinery, the biomachinery of what I might want to do. And it's all being driven by the sun, because if you remember, the sun split water to make hydrogen. So this is a way for me to wire sunlight, the energy of the sun, into cellular energy within the organism. And so that's what we did. We have Ralstonia eutropha, and these students right here, Chong Liu and Chris, were in my group. Brendan and Joe, we went over to, as of 3 years ago, we hadn't done any synthetic biology, so my students went over to Pam Silver and George Church's lab at Harvard Medical School, and we began working with them. And what happens is just what I told you, is we can take H2, drive a regular Calvin cycle to acetyl coenzyme A, and from there you make biomass. But this is a critical branch point. You can install other genes in the bacterium. And there's 4 genes that were installed, these 4 genes. And you can run and basically hijack the hydrogen that's finally going to biomass into a different metabolic pathway. And the reason we chose those 4 genes is just the organic chemistry of what we had to do. Acetyl-CoA is shown here. You need a gene, a ketothiolase, that's what this gene is, that enzyme breaks this carbon bond and makes this carbon-carbon bond. Then CTF, that gene hydrolyzes this off the other acetyl coenzyme A, and you get this molecule. You decarboxylate, that's what ADC does, it puts that enzyme in the cell. We get carbon dioxide out, which we can feed back into the system. Right here. And then we hydrogenate it to make alcohol. So now you can instead of having biomass, which you then need to chem engineer to a fuel, you can let the cellular machinery hijack it and install new cellular machinery and go right to an alcohol. When we did this a year and a half ago, or 2 years ago, we published this in PNAS, Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. We were happy, it worked. You can see if we take this top cycle, the biomass, we had an energy efficiency of 1.6%. We could make alcohols at 0.6%. The best biomass, the fastest growing crops, store solar energy at 1%. So this wasn't bad, but we weren't happy with it for one reason. It should have been a much higher efficiency. As a matter of fact, we saw this really strange observation. So here's the bacteria that we're using, these engineered bacteria. Now, these bacteria do only one thing. We don't feed them any food. I feed them one form of food. Their only food is hydrogen. We don't give them anything else. So they live off of hydrogen only. And we have to make that hydrogen at a potential from water splitting. And what we noticed is the bacteria would only live if we made hydrogen at 2.7 volts or greater. If we went to lower voltages, the bacteria died. And that's strange. Usually you don't take a living organism and electrocute it to make it live. But that's exactly what we had to do. We had to use this massive voltage to keep this bacterium living. And we were really confused by it. And it was bothersome to us because the maximum efficiency you can get out of the system is the applied potential that we're putting on to make its food, water splitting, to make hydrogen, divided by the thermodynamic potential. So if we're at 2.7 volts, we're already at a ceiling efficiency of 40%. We've lost 60% of efficiency. So this problem here really troubled us, and it took us a while. And we figured out, we thought you would be killing the bacteria where you're making oxygen, because from oxygen, you would think you could make reactive oxygen species. But it turns out that on the oxygen side, the bacteria were living and growing. Where they were dying was on their food source side, where we were making hydrogen. And we spent over 8 months to figure this out, and now looking back, it should have taken us one day to figure out. Because what happens at pH 7 water is the hydrogen potential to make hydrogen is minus 0.4 volts. At pH 7, the superoxide potential dips just inside the hydrogen potential. So you make superoxide, and then superoxide can go to H2O2, make reactive oxygen species, and kill the bacteria. So what was happening, if we didn't have a large overpotential so that we were making hydrogen quickly enough, some of the current was getting diverted to making reactive oxygen species, which were killing the bacteria. So we solved this problem in two ways. One is we use biology to our advantage. We challenge bacteria for 2 weeks with superoxide and H2O2. It died. A few of them lived, a few more lived. We took it out, we genetically sequenced it, and what we found out is that the bacteria had evolved to do a 45 base pair deletion and get rid of a membrane efflux gene. So there was a machine that was taking things out of the cell, and superoxide and hydrogen peroxide was coming in that machine. So we now have Ralstonia that are reactive oxygen species intolerant. So we have super bugs. But we did something that was even more facile and easier for us to do, and that was we came up with a new hydrogen catalyst. So the nickel molybdenum zinc of the original artificial leaf was making some superoxide. We figured out if we use cobalt metal and infuse a little phosphorus, 6%, we could make hydrogen and make no superoxide and no H2O2. So this catalyst system doesn't make reactive oxygen species. I don't have to overdrive it with a big potential. I can drop my potential to 1.8 volts, and because of that, my efficiency ceiling goes way up. So what we do is we put a little bit of Ralstonia in water. We then begin generating hydrogen. The Ralstonia eats the hydrogen, and it goes into an exponential growth phase. Then we adjust the hydrogen concentration to go into a steady state phase, so some bacteria are dying and some are living. We then take all the extra hydrogen and divert it along that fuels pathway. And we can do that at this lower voltage. So here's the bacteria, they're growing over 2 days. We then go to a steady state condition, take all the extra hydrogen, and we can make that isopropanol that I showed you. If we just do the biomass pathway, just let the bacteria grow in that exponential growth phase, with this catalyst system interfaced properly to this artificial leaf, we're able to hit biomass efficiencies of 10.2%. We can make isopropanol at 7.2%. We can make isobutanol and pentanol at 5.4%. We like these because these are immiscible with water. Isopropanol is miscible with water, and then you have to separate it. So by making isobutanol and pentanol, we take care of a separation problem. We can also make bioplastics like polyhydroxybutyrate. You can store it in vesicles inside the cell as a plastic. And those yields are way over the best crops, switchgrass, soy is 1%. The best durable microalgae are 3%. So we've gone over a factor of 10 over natural photosynthesis, a factor of 3 over microalgae, with this idea of separating solar-generated hydrogen and then in the dark, the engineered bacterium. A 1 liter reactor at an OD of 2, meaning the reactor scatters 99% of the light, that can mitigate 1,200 liters of CO2. So it's pulling CO2 from the air. Now, I'm not solving your CO2 problem. I'm sorry, I'm not sequestering, because once you have a fuel, what do? You burn it and you get the CO2 back. So this isn't, I'm not helping your 400 parts per million CO2, but it's carbon neutral. You don't need to dig fuels out of the ground necessarily anymore. The advantages of this approach is I don't need to have any extra cost with CO2 concentration, which you have to do for catalysts. These bacteria have natural enzymes, carbonic anhydrases, that do CO2 concentration. Because my organism doesn't need to see sunlight, the reactor design costs go way down. In algae, you have to, since the algae is absorbing sunlight, every algae needs to see sunlight to have high energy efficiency. So you need to pump water, and you need to have every algae seeing sunlight. Here, I have the artificial leaf at 12%, some people now hitting 15%, making hydrogen with inorganic chemistry, and in a vat, like a fermenter, in the dark, I'm putting hydrogen. So you have lower engineering costs. The footprint of the system is a factor of 10 less, because we're 10 times more efficient. And the other beauty of this approach is I'm not competing with crop resource land, because you're doing this water splitting, you don't need crop land to do that. If you keep letting your mind wander, what we've really done is we've put a nose on a bacterium to eat hydrogen that comes from solar water splitting. Once I have that hydrogen, I can power cellular synthesis. So I can put any types of genes in here, and you can start thinking of this as a renewable chemical synthesis platform now. And because I want to end now, I won't tell you this, but we have another bacterium that now can take nitrogen and make ammonia and do direct crop fertilization. So I really think this is an interesting idea, just thinking down the road. Maybe I'm thinking too far down the road sometimes, that this is a renewable chemical synthesis platform. So thank you for inviting me. It's been a long life journey to do this, so I'm happy to share this with you. But I spent most of my career actually just that's why Vili and I are such friends, because I had to do laser, and he does much more elegant laser spectroscopy than I do. But to time electrons and protons, that allowed us to make self-healing catalysts. And once we had these, we could integrate easily the materials using any water source to make the artificial leaf. And because we're then in a natural water source, using this trick of hydrogenases, we can pyrocellular synthesis. Right now, to do carbon dioxide to fuels, nitrogen to ammonia, but I think there's lots of opportunity here for the future. So with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions you might have.